The reading is from Mark's Gospel, chapter 10, verses 17 to 23. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?"
"Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not give false testimony. Do not defraud. Honor your father and mother." "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said. "Go, sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God."
Good morning, everyone. It's lovely to be back with you. You can tell from the color of my skin that it rained for 2 weeks in Spain. I don't think we saw any rain at all. It was absolutely glorious. The only problem was the flight returning last night was delayed, so I arrived home at 3:30 in the morning. So I'm feeling a little bit jet-lagged at the moment. But it's great to be back with you. You've been having so much fun in my absence. You had Tom Ward speaking on Pentecost morning, which was, I'm sure, fantastic. And then you had the Jubilee event, and to hear that we had 250 newcomers, visitors for that event is absolutely fantastic. And then last week we had David Baker speaking and Tom Hopper leading worship and lots of those who've grown up in Elmwood sharing what they're doing now. And that's a real cause for celebration. The impact that Elmwood has had on so many lives of those that are going on with the Lord and sharing their faith with others. And so I'm so glad that all of this has been happening. And then on top of that, for the first time in 2.25 years, we've actually come forward for communion. Goodness me, 2.25 years. In fact, Jill and I this morning were trying to work out how it worked because we'd forgotten. It has been so long. And thank you to Dave, who orchestrated it really well this morning, Dave McCormick, who was making sure everybody was in the right place. And thank you so much for all the volunteers that have come forward to help with communion and lots of new faces amongst them as well. So thank you for being willing to help in that really practical way. Now, if you can remember all the way back to before I went on holiday to Spain, we were thinking about gladiators ready. We were thinking about the fact that we need, as Christians, to be like gladiators, ready for a tough fight. We looked at the story of the Apostle Paul, and boy, did he go through it. What a tough time he had. And then we thought about the armor of God. We thought about the kind of enemy that we have and the kind of armor that we need to wear and how important prayer is if we are to be gladiators who are ready in the Christian fight. Well, we're continuing that series this morning, and I want us to look at the story that's been read to us about the rich young ruler. And I've entitled this message, "The Choice." The Choice. You know, following Jesus involves really, really tough choices. Let's consider the story of the rich young ruler who approached Jesus. First of all, we're told that he was rich. He lived in a grand home, wore fine clothes, and ate good food. He never had to worry about where his next meal was coming from. He was not concerned about paying his debts. This was a man who had great wealth. He was rich. And then in Luke 18, verse 18, a parallel passage in Luke's gospel, we're told that he's a ruler. He had status and influence. When he entered a room, people would notice him. His words were listened to. So a rich man, a ruler. And in Matthew 19 and verse 20, another parallel passage, it says that he was young. He had his whole life before him. He had dreams and goals for the future. He had health, strength, and energy. He was rich and influential, with youth on his side. Many of the things that the Western world pursues. It seems like this man has it all. He should have been very contented. However, the way he approaches Jesus suggests otherwise. He runs up to Jesus. Well, this suggests eagerness. He gives the impression of being in great need. We're told that he falls on his knees, which is a sign of humility and respect. He senses that Jesus can provide him with answers he has been desperately searching for. He calls Jesus a good teacher, and we'll return to this title in a moment. This young man is desperate to know how he can secure a place in heaven. The person who has everything on earth can still lack what is most important, eternal life. Verse 18, Jesus draws attention to this title, good teacher, to emphasize two things. Firstly, he emphasizes that only God is truly good. He is absolutely and completely good. He is perfectly good. You might believe you're living a good life, but God's standard is perfection. And next to God, we all fall short. We are all imperfect. Jesus may even be taking the chance here to hint at his own divinity. You call me good teacher, but surely only God is good. Are you seeing God in me? Am I an exact representation of the nature of God? Maybe there's a hint there to this young man of Christ's divinity. And then in verse 19, Jesus draws the man's attention to the commandments that deal with how we relate to one another. These are not about our relationship to God. All of the commands he mentions are about how he relates to other human beings, how he relates to the people around him. And then in verse 20, the young man confidently asserts that he's kept these commands since he was a boy. I have a great relationship, he says, with those around me. He feels he's a good person. But how does his goodness compare with the goodness of God? There's these wonderful words in verse 21. Jesus looked at him and loved him. Jesus looked at him and loved him. Even though this man might not choose to follow Jesus, Jesus loves him. Do we love the lost? Is our love for others unconditional, whether they choose to go the Jesus way or not? Then Jesus focused on the man's greatest need by making one request. His greatest need, and Jesus saw it, was for this man to put God first. That was his greatest need, his need to put God first. His great wealth was more important to him than his relationship with God. We're commanded to have no other gods before the one true God and not to make idols of anything. But this man was making an idol of his riches, of his money and his possessions. Now, I want to make it clear that this passage does not mean that all those who seek to follow Jesus must sell their possessions and give their money to the poor. It's not saying that. Not saying that everybody who follows Jesus, who wants to show that they're wholehearted, have to sell everything that they've got and give the money to the poor. This request is specific to this young ruler because it was his money that he was putting before his relationship to God. All those that follow Jesus must put him first. Every single one of us, if we're Christians, are obligated to put Jesus first, to put God first. We mustn't let anything we have or desire keep us from following Jesus. All barriers to serving him fully must be removed. And for this rich young ruler, his money was a barrier to him putting God first. If God asked you to give up your house, your car, your level of income, your position on the promotion ladder, your response may show your attitude towards money, whether it's your servant or your master. You know what really saddens me about this rich young ruler? We never hear of this young man again. He encounters Jesus, but we never ever hear of him again. I often say to people, do you know this man's name? And people think they've missed something. You know, we're never told this man's name. If he had chosen to put God first, we might all know his name today. He might be another Paul, another Peter, another great leader in the early church. We might all know his name today. He might have contributed to eternity in incredible ways as he served the Lord Jesus Christ. But all we're told about him is that he walked away sad. He knew he was passing up an incredible opportunity. But something was more important to him than God. Something had his heart in a vice. And for him, it was his money and his wealth. For us, it might not be money and wealth. It might be influence, prestige. It might be a relationship. It could be all sorts of different things that we've idolized, that we've put before God. And so in our heart of hearts, we know that we have to turn and sadly walk away from Jesus. The perfect one, the holy good one, who calls us to follow him, who loves him, who loves us, whatever choice we make. Just a few reflections. Wealth, power, and health do not give us what we most need. You say that again. Wealth, power, and health do not give us what we most need. This man had wealth. This man had influence. This man was a young man with all of his life before him, but he still comes and falls on his knees before Christ, wanting to know what he must do to secure eternal life. The world whispers in your ear, if you just had a little bit more money, life would be great. If people respected you just a little bit more because of what you've achieved, life would be great. If you could just run a little bit faster, jump a little bit higher, if you could just attain that health that you aspire to, life would be complete. Rubbish. Rubbish. It wouldn't, because we find our home in our relationship with God. This man walked away sad. He had all of these things, but he walks away sad. We might feel we're living a good life, but you know, the standard is not others, but God. Compared with God, every single one of us in this room falls far short. Not just a little bit. We fall a long way short. That's why Jesus had to come to pay the price for the things that we've done wrong. We cannot save ourselves. You know, sometimes I have conversations with people and I say to them, do you know you're going to heaven? And they turn around and they say, well, I hope so. You know, I don't live a bad life. I've never killed anyone. I try not to lie. I don't steal. You know, if anybody's going to get in, I stand a good chance. And I turn around and say, well, it's interesting. I know I'm going to heaven. And you can see them looking at me thinking, well, who do you think you are? What makes you so great that you know you've got a free pass straight into heaven? And I can explain that, well, actually, it's not on me. It's who I'm trusting in. It's the Lord Jesus Christ that saved me. So I know I have a place in heaven because of what Jesus has done for me, not because of what I've done to please God. This man needed that assurance. He needed to receive the gift of eternal life by putting his faith and trust in Jesus to make Jesus his Savior, but also, and this is what we often forget, Lord. Jesus had to come first. And that's a tough choice. And Jesus never, ever made that choice easy. He spelt it out what it was going to cost to follow Him. Finding life means surrendering what is most important to us to follow Jesus. Jesus must be Lord and Savior. We all want a Savior, but we don't always want a Lord. We want to live our own way, but be forgiven. But it doesn't work like that. We have to put God first. Will we be remembered as a wholehearted servant of God? Or will we walk away miserable? You know, there's no fence to sit on. There's no halfway house. Jesus, either Lord and Savior of your life, or he's not. There's only two camps you can be in. You can't sit on that fence with one leg dangling down either side. You're either in Christ or you're not. You're either for Christ or you're not. And this man walked away not for Jesus. Where do we stand today? Do you know you need assurance of eternal life? Do you know that the world is lying to you and saying that if you're healthy and if you're wealthy and if you're famous or you have influence, that you'll have everything that you need? Do you know that's a lie? It is. The only way you can find true fulfillment is through the Lord Jesus Christ. We don't know this man's name. I hope in his later life he might have turned to Christ and his name might now be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. But we don't know. Is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? You know, to be a Christian, we have to make tough choices. This rich young ruler found out he had a tough choice to make. Let's not pretend that it's easy to be a Christian, to put God first in everything. But boy, is it worth it. Boy, is it worth it to live a life that contributes to eternity as the Spirit of God works through you. That was something this young man never experienced, certainly not at this point in his life. Are you experiencing that today? It takes a gladiator to make the right choice. Let's pray. Lord God, we know that Satan is anesthetizing many people in our world today. That he is trying to take their pain away by offering them riches, by offering them health, by offering them influence. But there's only one way that secures eternal life. There's only one way of peace, of hope, of fulfillment, of unconditional love. And that, Lord Jesus, is to surrender to you. Lord, help us to surrender to you daily, to make you our Lord and King in everything, to have no idol before you. Help us to live in a way that eternity will know our name because we have stood for you. And Lord, I pray that if there are any today that don't have an assurance that they are yours for eternity, that they will be with you forever, that even today they would reach out and make you their Lord and King. In your precious name I pray.